Good evening, let's stand. Turn to number 391. 391. There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. Sing it together. 391. If you need a hymnal. All right, sing it with me.
There's a sweet, sweet spirit in this place. And I know.
Seated. We're going to step in just a minute, but you're like, you need to be seated. Is the weather not just gorgeous outside? I thought about if I could get away with it, and Brother David, I don't know how to do it, but everybody just grab a metal chair, go out in the parking lot and have church tonight. Amen. I mean, it's just gorgeous. Hallelujah. But I'm glad that you're here, and I will promise not to make any comments about different certain pants or refried beans. Amen. I had people leaving there going, preacher, 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 preacher. I told Brother Keith, I said, you ever had something go out of your mouth, and the minute it went out of your mouth, you're sitting there going, I'm going to pay for that one, amen. So thank you for your grace, but may God help us with our marriages, amen. And have many people watch by way of live stream, and it's encouraging that even when our folks go off, that they're still involved in the services. So I'm just encouraged to be your pastor, and I thank the Lord for you. But let's pray. And as we're praying, would you please remember Miss Gwen Thomas? We thought that her surgery would be tomorrow. And after I finished services today, was getting some texts from Brother Tommy and found out they took Miss Gwen about one-ish or so for surgery. So I went straight to the hospital, and she came through very well. She is in room 425 at Newton, 425 at Newton. But if I could say maybe wait till tomorrow to go by there, I'll go by after services, but maybe wait, give her some time. And when you do go in, I know you know this, and I'm just covering it for the sake of covering it. Use a little bit of etiquette, because that's somebody's had hip surgery or whatnot. I don't know if they want a 45-minute conversation. Are you with me, amen? So just be prayerful and considerate, but she came through very well, and so she'll go, I think she's going to be in Newton until Wednesday, and then they'll talk with Tommy and the family about the next steps for rehabilitation, but just keep remembering them in prayer. Also, how many remember we had spoken about and we've been praying for that little baby, Penelope? Everybody remember little Penelope? Well, the Lord saw fit to take Penelope home. And so be praying. The mom and dad are Jesse and Corsi Edwards. Just keep them in your prayers, that God would give them grace as they go through this in their life. But Father, we love you. And there's so many things that we need to lift to the throne of grace. There are so many people that are experiencing different things that just need the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ. And I thank you that your word says that we come boldly to the throne of grace to obtain help and mercy in the time of need. Thank you, Father, that you hear, answer, and even before we pray, you've already sent the answer. And God, I pray that you would bless God's people tonight. And Lord, my heart is very burdened for our families. And Lord, the families that are represented by our church family, those that have been visiting, those that we've been meeting, Lord, just in conversation and counseling. Very concerned, Father, that our families would glorify you, honor you. And so I do pray for words of wisdom. I pray, Father, that you would help me to say what I need to and not what I don't. And Father, you would help your word to take preeminence within our hearts and within our lives. I pray, Lord, tonight, I pray for the families. I pray for those that are away on spring break. There's many of them. And Lord, I pray that while they're away, would you just give them a good time? Would you help the families to relax together, to laugh together, to have a good time together? Give them just a sweet, sweet break while they're with their families. And Lord, I pray that our church, that God, we would honor you, glorify you, And this would be a place that people in Covington, Conyers, Lord, the areas around, that, Lord, there would be a church they could come to and be loved and be accepted, and they would hear the truth of the Word of God, and they'd be helped. And so, Father, I pray that this church, I pray that we would always be a lighthouse, Lord, for the lost, and a lighthouse for the hurting. Help, Lord, this light here at Newton Baptist Church, help it to shine far into all the world. And we know that the light that shines the farthest, that it shines the brightest at home. And so, Lord, help our light to shine for your glory. We love you. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Brother Keith.
All right, let's stand again. Turn to 508. 508. Love lifted me. 508. Lift it up. Sing out.
I was sinking deep in sin, far from the peaceful shore. Very deeply stained within, sinking to rise no more. But the master of the sea heard my despairing cry. From the waters lifted me, now safe am I. Love lifted me, love lifted me. When nothing else could help, love lifted me, love lifted me.
Appreciate Brother Bill, Sister Judy, appreciate y'all so much. Members that have joined and have absolutely jumped head over heels into the ministry here, we're very grateful for you. And Brother Bill, very, very grateful for you, sir. If you'd lead us in a word of prayer for the offering.
Heavenly Father, thank you for all the blessings that you've given us. Thank you for the opportunity to be together in your house tonight. You've given us so many blessings, our cups runneth over. Tonight, for our offering, let us return some of the gifts to you, so that it may be used for your work. Please lead, guide, and direct us to do your will. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
There's a lighthouse on a hillside that overlooks life's sea. When I'm tossed, it sends out a light that I might see. And the light that shines in darkness now will safely lead us o'er. And if it wasn't for that lighthouse, my ship would be no more.
I owe my life to back to that stormy night. With just in time, I saw the light. Yes, the light from that world.
Number 747-747. There is sunshine in my soul today. Sing it with me. There is sunshine in my soul today. More glorious and bright than goes in any earthly sky. For Jesus is my light. Oh, the sun shine, bless it. Sing that last verse. There is gladness. Sing it with me.
There is gladness in my soul today, and hope and love and praise, and for blessings which He gives me now, for joy in future days. Oh, the sunshine, blessed sunshine, these all happy moments roll. Jesus showed His smiling face. There is sunshine in my soul.
You may be seated.
Because that tomb is empty, we got a home in heaven. Isn't that wonderful to know? Blesses my heart tonight. Came
triumphant gone. Sin is defeated, gone. He lives forevermore. My friend, if you don't know my risen Savior, I beg of you, don't wait too late to pray. Don't wait until his bride has been completed. Don't wait until you hear him say it's too late. Gone, the stone is rolled back on. The tomb is empty, gone. Gone over death, triumphant, gone. Sin is defeated, gone. He lives forevermore. Gone, the stone is rolled back, gone. The tomb is to sit at the Father's side. Gone over death, triumphant, gone. Sin is defeated, gone. He lives forevermore. Gone, he lives forevermore.
Your Bibles and turn to the book of Hosea, if you don't mind, the book of Hosea. And remember, the book of Hosea is looking twofold. It's two visions, two views in view here. The first view is God with whom? God and, all together, one, two, three, God and Israel. The other one is the husband and, okay. So when you're looking at this and you're reading through the book of Hosea, Hosea is going to deal with his wife Gomer and the things that happened in their relationship, and it's also mirroring and it's a visual aid for how Israel has gone away from worshiping and loving God the way that Israel is supposed to. All through the Old Testament, it's very strong language, and I do not mean it inappropriately, but it's very strong language when it talks about going and worshiping other gods away from the God of heaven over and over. You will see the phrase and the words as you do your devotions, whoredoms. And it's talking about the unfaithfulness of Israel to worship God and God alone and bringing in other gods, little g, that they would worship. So Hosea, God is wanting to get Israel's attention. And if you people have looked and they've said, you know, I want to be like one of the Old Testament prophets. And I'm sitting there and I'm thinking inside my mind, have you ever read the Old Testament? I don't mean it ugly or wrong, but have you ever thought about, because again, many times the Old Testament prophets were a visual aid of how God was working in Israel's life. Have you ever looked at what God asked Ezekiel to do? I don't want to be Ezekiel. You ever looked at Isaiah? Isaiah went through the loss of a mate. You know what God told him? You cannot sorrow for her. There is no mourning allowed. Some of the Old Testament prophets, as God was using them to mirror how he was going to work with Israel, I just want to say on a 1 to 10 of the fun scale, it was a no fun scale. So we've got Hosea, we've got a preacher, we've got a prophet of Israel, and Hosea marries this lady named Gomer, and things maybe start off decently, but boy, they didn't end up decently. It turned into an absolute train wreck, and God has taken this book, and he is showing the pain of being unfaithful. Husband-wife relationship, man and God relationship. So now we look at this thing and how many would amen that we have an absolute train wreck with Hosea and Gomer? Say amen. If you don't realize it, and I've not done a good enough job explaining to you, I cannot stress to you the level of train wreck that we've got going on with Hosea and Gomer. It is very, very bad because the situation with God and Israel was so bad. So how do we fix this thing? How do we fix this thing? In counseling, one of the things that I come up against, and I believe in a lot of different areas, have you ever spoken with somebody that's going through whatever they're going through, whether it is loss and suffering, sickness and tragedy, marital, children, whatever it may be? Have you ever spoken with anybody at work or maybe in your own family? And when you're speaking with them, you know that the Word of God can help. You know the Word of God can change. You know the Word of God can fix. Would you say amen? Have you ever spoken with somebody that while you want to give them the unchanging truths of the Word of God that will help them in whatever situation that they are in, have you ever looked into their eyes? Have you ever read their body language? And what they're saying to you is, mine is beyond fixing. As a pastor, one of the things that is quite challenging is knowing in the Word of God that with this book right here, it doesn't matter what I face, it doesn't matter what you face, this Bible has the answers to fix everything we go through, amen or no. But have you ever gone through something that you thought you were too far gone to be fixed? Maybe, and I realized Sunday night on spring break weekend that I'm speaking to the cream of the cream, okay? I realize that. But maybe somebody's listening by way of live stream. It may be that somebody's going to go to the archives, and we've already had people asking about this series that they want to listen to this series. So maybe these next words would not be as much for you as somebody else that may listen to this later on down the road. One of the greatest things that I want you to get a hold of is no matter how, quote-unquote, far gone a marriage or situation is, I believe the Holy Spirit, I believe the Word of God, I believe Bible truth is strong enough, given time, that it can fix and mend any relationship. Okay, I got four of you out of what, 150 or so? My odds are not doing good tonight. The Word of God, given time, can mend and fix any relationship. Amen or no? Amen. See, we don't say amen because maybe we're sitting there, maybe we're thinking of that situation, and maybe we're thinking, there's no fixing this. And so I want to give you this evening, and I really, when I say I want to give it to you quickly, I really do. It may not turn out that way, but I do want to give it to you quickly. Because tonight, I want to give you some steps that as you help other couples and as you fortify and strengthen your relationship, these are things that God took in bringing Israel back to Himself, that Hosea used to bring Gomer back to Himself, that these are steps I truly believe that if we would use them and be faithful. Notice I keep using the phrase given time. Because people come to the house of God, do a Sunday morning service, and think it's going to fix 2 years' worth of their problems. This morning, people sat in here, and I know they got problems. I'm grateful that they're here, but in counseling, I know they have problems. Won't be back Sunday night, won't be back Wednesday night. I'm not mad at them. But I'm sitting there thinking people want some kind of magic wand on Sunday morning that in a 30-minute message, boom, you're going to fix 2 years of trash that need to be fixed in a relationship. So given time, consistent faithfulness. If you got family that they're having marital stress and marital problems, one of the greatest things that you can do is get them to be faithful, to be around the things of God and the preaching of God's Word. Sunday, I'm just going to say this, ready? Sunday morning ain't going to cut it. And so, I'm not preaching that y'all here on Sunday night, but understanding that given time, it's got to be faithful and it's got to be consistent and it's got to be the Word of God, obedience to the Word of God, continuing to allow the Word of God consistently to have an effect and a hold on our life. It will change people's lives. Amen or no? So would you take out your outlines? The outline should have been given out. And tonight we're going to look at the protection. We're looking at enemies and, you know, Brother Doug, and I don't mean, if I do embarrass, I don't mean to, but again, your security team, the work that y'all have done, thank you. I mean, I'm telling you, y'all have taken this extremely seriously, and thank you. When I'm looking at a church that I admire, if I use the name Adrian Rogers, how many are familiar with, Adrian Rogers, so you're familiar with Adrian Rogers, the church he pastored on Easter? They had a dude come in their church up there at Bellevue in Tennessee where Adrian Rogers pastored. And the dude had two guns, a .45 type gun and an assault rifle in his backpack. Thank you. Because there's enemies out there. And they're against the church, they're against people. And just as they're enemies, that we have to be very wise, and we've got somebody very competent in charge of that. We have a great security team. I publicly thank you for that. And as much as I want to make sure that our church is secure, and it's very important to me, I also want to make sure your homes are secure. And so what kind of protection can we give our homes against the enemy of discontentment? And this is what I want to give you. Look at your outlines. Well, it's not my fault. I typed them. They are printed. Somebody look on my... Where's Mike Eccles at? Well, I'm going to blame it on Mike. He's not in here. Okay. Is my face turning red? Good. Okay. Listen, it may not come across like it, but this morning night, I really have tried to put in a lot of effort because this is very, very, very important to me. But as you're going through that, take your outlines from this morning and let's look at them. That one you have. All right. Well, Julian, you have that one. As we're waiting on these other outlines, sort of review and sort of pick up steam going downhill now. We talked about this morning, we ended the service with some practical principles that we could look at as we're going to start protecting our homes and marriages from discontentment. What was it, Brother Julian, and I'll repeat it for live stream. Brother Julian, what was number one, the first thing that we covered? They started with C's.
Cherish.
Cherish whom?
Your mate.
Cherish your mate. Just have a sweet love. The men are handing out for tonight. Thank y'all for bailing me out, gentlemen. But cherish your mate. Cherish your mate. Now, ready for this? I want to give you homework. In counseling, what I've started doing is if people don't do their homework, we're not having the next counseling session. If they don't care enough to do homework, then they're just going to waste my time, and I don't have enough to waste. And so I want to give you some homework. Now, you don't have to have it. You can come back next week, and I'm still going to preach to you. But what I'd like for you to do is this. Besides cherish your mate, and remember this morning we had you look at them and say a character trait that you appreciated about them. Beside cherish your mate, would you just make this note, list traits that you appreciate about your wife, about your husband, about your mate. List traits that you appreciate about your mate. And some may say, oh, they already know. You know, they may know, but it is so neat to be reminded of those things over and over and over again. So cherish your mate. Number two, somebody help me with number two. Just yell it out and I'll say it behind the pulpit for live stream. What was the second thing? Control your thoughts. Beside that, would you just put these words, remove negativity. Have you ever been around folks that's like, glory to God, if you say one more thing negative, I'm going to go jump somewhere. It's like everything's negative. Negative, 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 negative. Remove that. Now watch this. Remove that from your marriage. Remove that from your marriage. Because I promise you this. If you and I are instruments of negativity toward our wife and toward our children, and it's just incessant, don't worry. The devil will take great pride in making sure somebody comes along and appreciates them. Now stick with me. Please don't get mad at me tonight. I've not even gotten to the message. Remove negativity. Take the time that you would spend talking negatively about them and speak positively about them. Have y'all ever heard the story of the farmer with his mule? Would y'all like to hear the story of the farmer with his mule? Okay, yeah. Smart aleck. The farmer had a mule. Farmer would go to the hardware store for Saturday. He'd walk in and Brother Bill, he'd be talking about that's the greatest mule anybody could ever have. He's always bragging on that mule. Saturday after Saturday, that farmer would go in and brag on that mule. Finally, one Saturday, a younger farmer just could not take it anymore, and he looked at the man and says, I got to have that mule. The man said, no way. That mule is the most awesome mule that anybody could ever have. He's not for sale. Next week, comes in bragging on that mule. The farmer said, listen, I will pay you double of whatever you ask. I've got to have that mule. The farmer looked at him and said, well, I ought not do this, but I'm going to sell you the mule. And so the farmer sold him the mule, and a week went by, and the next Saturday they all going to gather together at the hardware store again, and the old farmer that sold the mule's in there, and the young farmer comes bursting in. You lied to me. That is the sorriest, most worthless, laziest, dumbest mule I have ever seen in my life. The old farmer just leaned back and said, now, son, you ain't never going to get rid of that mule that way. Now, I'm not saying that your mate is a mule. If that's what you took from the illustration, that was the wrong thing. But isn't it amazing, negativity? You ever been around somebody that if they're eating the finest of the cuisine, they're going to find something to bellyache about it? Have you ever been around somebody that can eat something as simple as cornbread and buttermilk? And I don't think that's simple. I think that's a delicatessen. Somebody say amen. But no matter how simple they're eating, it's like they're eating the greatest stuff in the world. Have you ever been around somebody that no matter what they're eating, it's so good that you just want to reach over their plate and try it? Because obviously it's got to be different. Negativity. Remove negativity from your marriage. Start bragging on your wife. I know we make jokes about all this kind of stuff, and I've tried to make it where it's very palpable for you. But brag on your wife. Brag on your husband. You say, well, I can't find nothing to brag about. Brag by faith until it comes around. Are you with me? Amen. Cherish your mate. Control your thoughts. Consider your mate. Be nice to him. Make time for him. As Brother Brian comes in and I transition, I'm going to start another life group class and find an age group and a niche that won't impede. I will not take anybody from other classes. That's not what it's about. But I'm going to be honest with you. I'm concerned about these young couples with these kids and their whole life's got to run around a snot nose and a dirty diaper. And they have no time, no attention, no care, no consideration for her or him. And I'm watching, I'm going, this is the disintegration of a relationship. These kids were not given to drive you apart. They were given to bring you together so that you would raise a child that would honor and glorify God. And I'm very concerned that mamas and daddies, without pinpointing either sex, because it's not a sexist statement, but all of a sudden these couples are getting so into little Johnny and little Susie that they've totally forgotten about the one that they married. And I'm just telling you, it is disaster in the making. Consider your mate. Have time for him. Number four, cut off relationships with the opposite sex. Whether it's a man or woman, and I get people, and they give me these looks like it's innocent. There's nothing wrong with it. This is just Pastor Tony preaching again. And I hear all this stuff. But you know what, ma'am, sir? You're not the one that has to deal with the wreck that comes down the road there, down the tracks there, because of these marriages that are busting up and infidelity has settled in because something started out seemingly innocent, and the devil never has anything innocent. People look at me and say, well, I'm just going to sit on the fence. An old preacher one time said this, don't sit on the fence because the devil owns the fence. Are you with me? Amen. So all of a sudden, some of the stuff we're playing around with, I'm just lovingly as your pastor telling you, stop playing around with it. Then number five, commit to loving your mate. And that's where these next things are going to come in on your outline. If you would allow me. Gentlemen, would y'all put Hosea 2 verse 14? Let's look at Hosea 2. And if we could start in about verse 14. And if you got your Bibles, I'd turn there. Hosea 2 and verse 14. Therefore, behold, he's talking about a relationship now that has gone south, gone crazy. It is a train wreck, whether it's with Israel and God or Hosea and Gomer. He says, let me give you some steps that's going to happen of bringing Israel back to myself because he's brought judgment down. If you read all these passages, man, there's great judgment in all this. And he says, therefore, behold, and just for sake of our time, let me bring out just a few things. Therefore, behold, I will allure her. Well, that didn't go together. I mean, she's hurt him so bad. If they said, behold, I will shoot her, we would say that makes sense. And I'm not trying to be ugly with that. But see, watch this. If you and I, in marriage and every other aspect of life, if you and I respond by the way that our flesh would want us to respond, then we're just going to end up in a bigger mess. The things of the spirit and the things of the flesh are not the same. And so when you say, well, I don't feel like doing that, if it's spiritual stuff, the reason that you don't feel like doing that is because you're walking in the flesh. And one of the things that's killing us is the flesh life is ruining our relationships. Therefore, behold, I will allure her. That goes against every grain of our thought. See, now watch this. Remember, we got Hosea and Gomer, and we've got Israel and God. God says, I'm going to allure Israel back to me. If I'm God and Israel has done all those things, I would have a propensity in my humanness say, I will wipe Israel off the face of the earth, and I will do what I told Moses I was going to do. I'm going to totally destroy Israel, and I'm going to raise up another group of people that will appreciate me. But God says, I will allure her. And then he says, I will bring her into the wilderness and speak comfortably unto her. Verse 15, the Bible says,
And I will give her her vineyards from thence, and the valley of Achor for a door of hope. That valley of weeping, I'm going to make a door of hope. Her sorrow will turn to joy. She shall sing there as in the days of her youth, as in, notice now, Hosea and Gomer, Israel and God. I will let her sing there as in the days of her youth, as in the day when she came up out of the land of Egypt. Verse 16, if you don't mind. And it shall be at that day, saith the Lord, that thou shalt call me Ishi, and shalt no, call me no more Baali. What he says right here is this. Gomer was going to come back, and I want to be proper, and it's going to be a little challenging. You remember this morning we read verses of pretty scathing verses where the verses talked about, I will strip you naked, I'll put you out in the wilderness. I mean, remember those verses? Very strong verses. They would take this situation or a woman or a man, they would strip them to the nude, and they literally would put them on the auction blocks and sell them literally based upon their looks and how they could benefit the buyer. And God says here, he says, I'm not asking you to come back. I'm not asking you to come back as my servant. I'm asking you to come back as my wife. I don't need you to come back as a servant. I want you to come back into the relationship that I have set for you, that I have prepared for you. I want you to come back not as some low groveling off of the auction block servant. I want you to come back to the position that I had for you, Israel, that I have for you, Gomer. I want you to come back to me, and I want you to be my wife. When you read on later through here, you'll see one of the most beautiful scenes of when that man of God, that prophet, goes to that human flesh market, and that prophet, throwing aside all of his reputation, all of his embarrassment, all of his shame, literally, when you read through this in Hosea, he's going to go there to the market that she's standing there nude for other men to bid on her body. And Hosea outbids them all and says, that's my wife, and I want her back home. That's powerful. What price, ma'am, sir, what price would you be willing to pay to get your marriage back to where God intended it? And so let's go through these things. Number A, ready? Commitment in marriage is number two. Commitment in marriage is number two. A, initiate the love relationship. Initiate the love relationship. And this right here is a whole message in and of itself. Each one of these points, Brother David, is just a message all in of itself. It's just, there's just a lot here. Initiate the love relationship. In verse 14, therefore, behold, I will allure her. Allure her. Would you underline allure her in your Bibles if you mark in your Bible? Allure her. Allure. Allure. What is allure? What base word, foundational word is in the word allure that just sort of jumps out at you? Allure. 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 Joel, I'm not trying to talk fishing terms, but did you get this? Behold, I will allure her. A lure. I'm going to woo her back to me. If I'm fishing, I'm going to listen to Brother Joel, and if he's not around, I'm throwing in a piece of dynamite. Somebody say amen. But you're going to look through that tackle box, and depending on the color of the water, according to the weather, according to the water temperature, all this kind of stuff that I have no idea what I'm talking about. You're going to pick a lure, and you're going to put it on a line, and you're going to throw it out there because you're trying to catch its attention. And what you're doing, if you're Texas rigging and bumping that worm off the thing, if you're spinner baiting, plowing it through the water, whatever, little jig and pull, whatever you're doing, what you're trying to do is you're trying to get the attention of what you're trying to catch. A lure. Trying to woo them in to catch their attention. Now, y'all all look at me like I'm the dumbest thing in the world. Let me put it in modern terminology without getting in trouble. Allure. An hour and a half in front of a mirror. Stick with me. Y'all all over here. Oh, no, no, no. You know what you women did? Y'all are wicked. It's all y'all's fault. Because we men were minding our own business. Brother David Fielder, we were singing, glory to God, love Jesus, kumbaya, I surrender all. And all of a sudden, a woman came by. And don't tell me that you weren't trying to get his attention. Like those Disney movies where the cologne wastes off and it's like, do-do-do-do-do-do. Are you with me? Now, I'm trying to make it where you'll, are you following the verse now? Now, it's not exactly like that, okay? But like the ladies, you know, I don't know. With Stacy, and she's in the nursery, so I've got a maid tonight, amen. But is she in here? What's somebody say? Next point. My favorite time of the year is the fall of the year. You can say, yeah, it's college football. Has nothing to do with college football. Has everything to do when I first met Stacy. There is smell of the cologne that she wore when I first met her. Dalton, Georgia, the leaves changing colors. There are so many things that are associated with when she and I first met that I find I love because it was all those, she caught my attention. You know what's so sweet about your relationship? If we could just be honest for just a moment without, you know, if we could just be honest. Somehow Herman Bradford caught Maggie's attention. And I don't mean that as a joke. It's not a joke. Oh, I'm just telling you, by way of live stream, there's no way you're picking up what's going on in this church tonight. But seriously, caught her attention. I'm going on for that. But see, they caught your attention. Let me ask you a question. How come we spent so much time getting ready for the other person when we were dating, and when we got married, we just let everything go, pfft? Stick with me. I'm not talking about just the fleshly. If all you pick up from these messages is a fleshly aspect, I have failed you. That is by far no means what I mean. The kindness, the thoughtfulness, the cards, the flowers. Man, guys would, when dating and all, you ever seen these kids coming into a restaurant and you forget that it's prom weekend and all you want to do is get something to eat, and all of a sudden the restaurant's invaded by all these corsages and fancy dress and guys with tuxedos on and all this pomp and circumstance and pulling out chairs for them and all this kind of stuff? If we lived married life like we did dating life, we may enjoy what marriage is really all about. My question for this one, and I need to go on, is when did you stop dating? When did you stop dating? I love everybody. I guess I'm just honored to pastor people that's been married longer than I've been in the ministry, or some even, and I mean this is no joke, but literally been married longer than I have been living. I am honored. I don't feel like I can teach you anything. I need to learn from you. And I mean that with the greatest of respect. But I love the way you hold hands. I love the way you see them holding open the doors. If our younger couples would wake up and watch our older couples, they would see how much of a gentleman and a lady that they treat each other. Now you say, well, boy, they can sure pick on each other. Man, after 60 years, somebody's earned it. And they're picking. It's not like these young couples that's cutting the throat for blood. Allure. Wait a minute. If I was speaking to a lot of younger couples tonight, I would let this thing rip. Because what happens is we get what we want, quote unquote, and then we just let it all die out. The conquest is over. When in reality, the battle has only just begun. Initiate. Well, bless God, I'm waiting for her to take the first step. Sir, men, can I just talk to you from my heart? It doesn't matter if she takes the first step or not. It doesn't matter who took the first step last time. You're a grown man. Act like it. I don't mean it ugly, but you act like a man. You take the responsibility as a man. You get your feelings off your shoulders. I'm sure every generation's had to deal with it, but my soul, can somebody just help me out with a wee bit of an amen that we got a bunch of men that get offended over the dumbest things? Grow up, amen. Are you with me? I'm sinking here by myself. Amen or no? So look at you say, well, listen, tonight, allure her. Hold her hand. Buy her flowers. Invest in it. We're going to talk about that in a minute. But allure her. Catch her attention. Now watch this. Catch her attention with your kindness. Catch her attention with your gentleness. Catch her attention with you noticing things. Notice when she gets her hair done. Notice when she fixes something special. Just if you and I would take time, if we would notice the little things, those are the big things. Watch what he says here. And I got to hurry. Therefore, behold, I will allure her. The first thing is initiate the love covenant. Be there. Insist. Your word is insist. Insist on times together. These steps is initiate it and then insist on times alone. He says, therefore, behold, I will lure and bring her into the wilderness. One of the things about America is we've got so much going on, we don't even know what we're doing anymore. Our schedules are so crazy. For us to have all of these gadgets and all these machines in our house that's supposed to save us time, we're stressing out. Our hearts aren't keeping up. Stress is absolutely killing America. When America dies, you can put entertainment on one side of the gravestone and stress on the other side of the gravestone. It's killing us, folks. Get into the wilderness. And what I mean by that is, and I'm not saying go on a camping trip to get into the wilderness. What I'm saying is that when do you ever have a time alone? We're raising children, we're raising grandchildren, we've got people over our house, we've got financial worries. We're at a place important in America that if the older that any of us get, they're spending every bit of the retirement we put into the government. People that used to be able to take off and be able to retire at 60 are now working at 65, and now they're working at 70, and now they're working at 75. There's going to come a point in place that, retirement, what does that word mean again? We've got so much going on in our lives that if you and I, no matter your age, if we don't purposefully set aside time for our marriage, there's not going to be any time for it. And we're all always saying, you know, maybe next week or maybe tomorrow, maybe down the road or maybe next month I'll get to it. Have y'all ever, is it only me? Or is it absolutely crazy that we have already jumped slap dab into April of 2016? April of this year. And before we know it, we're going to be talking about vision night for 2017. And the days aren't slowing down, friends. You and I are not getting more time. Our demands are not lessening. And if we don't make purposeful time to spend time with each other, then I promise you this, you won't spend time with each other. I've counseled some folks and they're like, well, I get along with them and we don't know how to talk and we don't know what to do. Can I just, without being, I mean, I got to hurt. Can I tell you what to do? Learn. Learn how to be alone with each other. You don't always need a kid. You don't always need a friend. I've had a council of missionaries that thought that for them to go out to eat or for them to do anything on the field, that they always had to have another missionary couple with them. And it's like if they're ever by themselves, they don't know what to do. I'm like, glory to God, get along, go off somewhere and learn how to talk not at each other. Learn how to talk to each other. Learn how to share your heart with each other. There are things that we, quote unquote, used to do that we need to bring back into our hearts and in our lives. Are you with me, amen? All right. C. B was the word is insist. C. Impart, I-M-P-A-R-T, impart love vocally. Therefore, behold, verse 14, I will lure her. I will bring her into the wilderness and then speak comfortably unto her. Come on, woman, get in the car now. Ladies trying to do something in the church, loving other people's kids. Man sitting in a car for the last 10 minutes. Woman over there says, where you been? Get in the car. I'm hungry. Preach, preach too long. Glory to God. Church is 6 or 7, not 6 or 7:05. Are you with me? Well, that's sweet, isn't it? Glory to God, didn't you get my clothes washed? Why is my underwear pink? And if you ain't never experienced that, you ain't been married. Every man in here is going, yeah, I got to say to them too, amen. It's part of life. Okay, there's no dying during the church service, okay? But watch this. Impart love vocally. Some of y'all, I'm not trying to stalk you or be sneaky, but I'll be honest. And again, I'm not trying to over accentuate something. I love our couples in here that's been married for such a season. I love not that I'm spying on you, but to notice you when you don't think anybody's noticing you and you grab each other's hands. He'll take the back of his hand and put it in the small of her back as they're going down the hallway. The way that she looks up at him. When I'm preaching and say something, and again, they've been married longer than I've been alive, and they're allowed to do this. And I say something, and she looks at him and grins, and he looks down at her and grins. And I have no idea why they're grinning, but I know it's got to be good. Are you with me? When's the last time you just looked at them and from your heart? Not because you wanted anything. It's not a plot or a ploy. When's the last time you just looked at them and said, you know what? I am stinking crazy about you. Wow. Do you just realize how awesome you are? Do you just realize that, you know, of all the people God could have given me, God's blessed me with you? When's the last time? Just take her hand, and it may freak her out. I don't mean it's ugly. But take her hand and just start praying. Dear Lord, I'm the luckiest man alive. And I'm not trying to get anything from my wife, and I'm not trying to embarrass her. We're just by ourselves. But Lord, I just wanted her to hear me thank you for giving her to me. God, you are so good. I am holding the hand of the greatest woman in the world. Thank you, Jesus, for giving this lady to me. Now, you may not believe me, but that'll do something for your marriage. And it'll do something for you. Does that make sense? Amen? When's the last time they heard you impart love to them vocally by you just telling them how sweet, wonderful, and special they are? Initiate the love relationship. Insist on times alone. Impart love vocally. Invest in your love for her or him. But I'll use her because we need to talk to the men. Verse 15 says, and I will give her her vineyards from thence in the valley of Achor for a door of hope. And these are dealing with plots of land that Israel would have been very familiar with. And she shall sing there, and in the days of her youth, as in the days of her youth, and as in the days when she came up out of Egypt, he says, I will give her. Now, I am not poking at anybody's hobby. Please don't take this from this illustration. But men, do we really think our wives are so ignorant that we can spend money, hundreds and hundreds, maybe possibly thousands of dollars on some type of hobby or some type of object, and then we yell at her for spending $24.95 at Dollar General? Well, now we're just not having fun, are we? Did I tell you about the guy and his mule? We can go by and see vehicles. We go through little itches. I'll confess my sin so that you don't feel like I'm yelling at you. I don't know what I'm doing fishing. I try hard, but I don't know what I'm doing. But Ron Johnson, I promise you, there is an itch in me to go to Bass Pro Shop and buy a brand new bait casting reel that I can't see straight right now. And I can't determine if it's the flesh or the Spirit of God leading me. We men get together and we'll talk. Yeah, but the Lord of God, you know, went down to McDonald's, that Summit dealership, and got that new four-barrel carburetor for that car. Got on that. And whoa, that thing sounds good. How much it cost? I don't know, $600. You went to Kroger and spent what? Are you with me? Now, ladies, don't start amening too much. You start sitting there going, hallelujah. Please, I've got enough problems in my life, okay? But what I'm saying is this. Was Gomer, quote-unquote, worth it? and to our flesh, we would just resoundingly say, uh-uh, no, sir. Was Israel worth it? We would say, what a terrible group of people that would forsake the God of heaven. Boy, I tell you, if God did everything for me that God did for Israel, I wouldn't be unfaithful to Him. And all I'm saying is this. I'm not trying to cause a financial war. Good gravy, please. But I am saying this. Invest in your love for each other. You say, well, we don't have a whole lot of money. Some of the things I found out that would be treasured and are treasured, they didn't cost anything, guys. I've got a drawer in my office. It's got special things from funerals to people's notes. I've got one at home that's full, and I'm fixing to have to empty this one out. But what's in there is when the kids or people send cards or notes or whatnot, I try to save them. And some of the sweetest things in there are made out of construction paper. They're a little bulky. They got real thick crayon lines on them. They're not spelled correctly. They're not symmetrically sound when it comes to art. Some of them I have to have the kid tell me what it is that they drew because I have no idea what it is. But they're investments of love to a guy that they call pastor and don't understand what they're saying. Their mom and dad calls me pastor. The Awana teacher or the life group teacher has said, maybe we should maybe write a card for Pastor and Miss Stacy. And what they did, they went home and they drew something and they wrote something. You say, preacher, of all the things in your life, what's some of the most valuable, valuable things? It's not the things that were made purchased by money. It's the things that if God would allow me age and time, I would hope that I would preach until my very last day upon this earth. In the likelihood with the processes of time, that may not happen. But one day, I will sit around remembering people that I pastored, churches that mean so much to me, people that are so dear to me. And I will look and I will say, as I'm thumbing through and seeing all these drawings and all these little cards, of people now that have kids that are older than they were when they wrote that to Pastor Tony. Some things can be bought with money, and some things are priceless. The poem that you would write, it may not rhyme, but it'd bring a tear to your wife's eye. Not because it sounds so bad, but it'd bring a tear to your wife's eye that you took the time just to write down the thoughts from your heart, to put them on a piece of paper to hand to her. We make jokes about a lot of things. But sometimes it's the awkward way that most men try to fold the clothes that are in the dryer. And she may end up folding them again, because I've not met many men that we know what we're doing with clothes from a dryer. But for her to walk in and pass out that you're folding clothes in a dryer would be a coronary. And she may never say anything to you. But if she passes you grinning when you're there folding the clothes, it's a dryer. As she heads to the bedroom to slip off her work shoes and put on her sweatpants, she'll be grinning. And she'll be thinking, is he drunk? What's got into him? Because, are you following the illustration? It's investment of love. And sometimes it's financially. I'm of the point and place that you don't hear me ripping people for going on vacation. I think that we're in a society that I would ask God to give you that opportunity to be able to get away and get alone. As your pastor, if I was a doctor, I would prescribe that for all of God's children. But you need to invest in each other. Sometimes it's financial. Sometimes it's the talents God has given you. Sometimes it's the words. Invest in each other. And then your last one's there. Inspire each other. Inspire each other. She's going to sing again. And the last one is enjoy each other. You've been very patient, and I am very grateful for that. But God brought Israel back to Him when Israel was the one that hurt Him. And Hosea brought Gomer back to him when Gomer had hurt him. And I just believe this. I believe that our relationships can be sweet and godly and God-honoring. And can I just say this? A boatload of fun. I was looking at a guy the other day that was talking about the ministry, and I gave him these words, and I close. I said to this young preacher, I said, when the ministry gets to the point in place that it's no longer fun, I did not say easy. I said, when it comes to the point in place that ministry is no longer fun, I was like, and I said the young preacher's name, I said, something is wrong somewhere. And I want you to look at me, and I believe this with all my heart, I believe this is very biblical. When our marriages, I did not say not easy, when our marriages are no longer fun, we may be going through tests, we may be going through trials. Notice the difference of what I'm saying. When our marriages are no longer fun, I think we've got to take a step back and we've got to realize there's a problem somewhere. Does that make sense? Amen? Would you do me a favor tonight? From my knowledge, as I've looked over the congregation, I believe all of you have given a profession of faith that you have trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. Could we just do this? If you're beside your mate, we're going to have every head bowed and every eye closed. Would you just take a moment? Quietly, snuggle up close, I don't care. Would you take a moment and pray with your mate? Would you just take a moment and pray with your mate? You say, well, my mate's in the nursery. So I'm not going to pray with Stacy, I'm going to pray for Stacy. You are not married. You are praying that God would give you wisdom to know who He is bringing across your path. As we bow our heads and as we pray, Father, we love You. And You brought us to Yourself when we have failed You, when we have embarrassed You, we have humiliated You. But You drew us to Yourself. You initiated a love relationship. Even the Scripture teaches us that we love You because You first loved us. You gave Yourself for us. And Father, I pray tonight that You would help us to initiate and to go first in showing, demonstrating the love of the Lord Jesus Christ. Father, I realize that there is a great possibility that whether in this auditorium, by way of live stream, or somebody listening to this message later on down the road, that there are situations that people go through in marriage that they have been hurt very, very, very deeply. And there's no jokes about that, and there's no fun with that. They've been hurt very deeply. And God, I humbly ask that You would grant them right now, as they're listening to my voice, just a sweet measure of grace. Would You grant them forgiveness? Would You grant them the power to be able to take the right steps? And may they choose that direction. And Father, would You help our relationships, Lord, not to disintegrate because we've become discontent. Help us, Heavenly Father, to be able to take a look at the one that You've given us and help us to have a heart full of gratitude and gratefulness. And instead of focusing on what's wrong, help us to brag on them for what's right. Father, I love You. And You've been so good to our church, my family, these families. We could break out into the old-time chorus that says, God is so good. God is so good. He's so good to me. And part of that goodness is Your grace and mercy through all that we go through. And Lord, that gift You gave us called a mate. Help, Father, us not to settle for a relationship that would be beneath the Word of God, but help us to experience in the fullness the sweet joy that You have outlined when it comes to marriage. Help, Lord, our kids and help our grandkids. Help them to look within our marriage, and though it may gross them out and though it may put a smile on their face or make them shake their head, help our children and our grandchildren to look upon our marriages and to say as they walk away grinning, hey, God, one day, give me a marriage like that. May that be of a truth in all of our lives. For we ask all this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. Well, you're greatly loved. You know you're wonderful. You're absolutely awesome. And I just really don't know why, Brother David Croom, you're still sitting in the auditorium. Y'all are dismissed. Love on each other and get out of here. God bless your hearts. I love you.